Tell us a bit about John James Audubon. How important was he and is he to birding?
Yeah, I mean, he's a very, very renowned figure. It's not for nothing that his name graces the National Audubon Society. You know, it's almost synonymous with birds in America. But his reputation, once sterling, has taken a huge hit in the last decade or so for many reasons. There are scientific problems. So he has been accused of scientific fraud, of wholesale making up a species of bird that doesn't actually exist and that contributed to his rise to fame. He is responsible for pushing out certain myths about birds, like the idea is that they can't smell, which is not true and withstood the test of time for a long time because of Audubon's terrible experiments. And mostly, I think the thing we're here to talk about today, he was also kind of a terrible human. Mm. He dug up the graves of many Native American people, stole their skulls, and sent them to a physician named Samuel Morton, who used those skulls in studies aiming to prove that Caucasians were intellectually superior than other peoples. Morton's work was the foundation of the scientific racism movement, and Audubon helped him in performing that work through these grisly acts of body snatching. Those remains still have not been repatriated.
It's taken nearly four decades for this kind of closure. The Dotson family walks up to the Philadelphia Medical Examiner's office. Inside the remains, bones and fragments of Katricia and Zanetta, just 12 and 14, both killed in the 1985 MOVE bombing.
Finally getting them a resting place permanently. I can do this for them.
The remains were tucked away, some say hidden, only discovered by a staffer in the past few years. It's unclear why they were never given to the family before.
And these particular remains that are being released today were just put in a box and forgotten.
Cedric Lodge remained silent leaving federal court Wednesday. The former morgue manager at Harvard Medical School is accused of stealing body parts from the morgue and selling them across state lines.
Do you have any remorse?
The criminal complaint names Katrina McLean, the owner of a shop called Cat's Creepy Creations. In October of 2020, she allegedly agreed to purchase two dissected faces for $600. Her business's Instagram account shows products made with human bones. She's also accused of shipping human skin to a man named Jeremy Pauly in Pennsylvania to have the skin tanned to create leather. Pauly was arrested in Pennsylvania last year. According to the federal indictment, he also purchased several stolen human remains from a mortuary employee in Arkansas. His Instagram account shows off a collection of human bones, teeth, and brains. The federal indictment also names Joshua Taylor in Pennsylvania as a buyer who sent the lodges more than $37,000 via PayPal for human remains. One payment of $1,000 was sent with a memo that read Head Number 7. Another $200 payment was sent with a memo that reads Brains.
The Cows, Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Wednesday, June 28, 2023, so I have been told. I'd said at the beginning of the month we'd have programs that seemed random, but now that we get to the end of the month, they do not seem random at all. There's so much connection between so many of the programs, regardless of the subject matter for today. I guess before we get started, one, people should recall we were talking about all of this. One, just this past spring, Dr. Sean Utsi, guest on the program, I thought we were going to talk about the work of Dr. Francis Kress Welsing, and then I saw he had all of these very detailed documentaries on the history of grave robbing at the Virginia Medical College. Same premise, really, just you can kind of subtract the phrenology aspect and measuring skulls, but the same thing, robbing graves and robbing black cemeteries in Virginia for white medical students to benefit and improve their anatomy skills. We just talked about all of that in great detail, even referenced the great Harriet A. Washington, her book Medical Apartheid, where she has a whole chapter talking about grave robbing and how the slaves, they wished, please let me die in the summertime so that I will rot quickly and they will not be able to dig me up and do God knows what with my remains. The great Harriet A. Washington, and even related, referenced in some of the work we're talking about today, Dana Rainey Berry's book, The Price for Their Pound of Flesh, The Value of the Enslaved from Womb to Grave in the Building of a Nation, White Nation, really, but amazing scholarship. Once again, we read Medical Apartheid in the book club, The Price for Their Pound of Flesh, not yet, but both amazing, lots of reasons why reading more important than watching television. Now, specifically to the audio that we heard, we played that full segment before that was CBC, Canadian Broadcasting Channel, where they were just a few days ago talking about the legacy of John James Audubon. Maybe we should rethink. Even, in fact, I thought it was important. They talked about how he was lying and making up species. Some of that's in the work we'll talk about today, too. But, man, all of that old lying and deception. They talk about the fake studies and the fake records. Long history of that, apparently. They said that's not the real controversy with Mr. Audubon. The real controversy, digging up those graves, skulls to Mr. Morton. I said, wow. I told you I was in Buffalo this year, New York State, for the trial of Peyton Gendron, and I went to the Special Collections, Buffalo, Erie County, Downtown Library. They had a whole big exhibit, and they started their Special Collections with Mark Twain, Huck Finn, Nigger Jim, and then they went to John James Audubon, and they did not say one word. Grave robbing? Nope. Slaves? Nope. Racist? Nope. Look at these birds. Ah, isn't that majestic? They had the big prints, the big plates. It takes like five people to turn the page. They had that. They just, grave rot, you know, not one peep. That was the beginning of the year at the trial of Peyton Gendron. Everything connected. The second segment was Move. Cannot believe how much time we spent talking about Move, other side of the continent. The bombing of the Move facility, May 1985, Sioux Africa was not present, 11 fatalities, half of them children, and just now, all these decades later, the remains at UPenn not returned to the family. Now that's been reversed, but what in the world, 21st century, what? And then that final segment, and that was even more recent, just a few days ago up at Harvard, where they're selling body parts illicitly on the black market, so-called. That oddity shop, we just talked about that sort of thing. The serial killer museums and murderabilia, as it's called. But tanning skin, showing off on your IG and social media that you got all these trinkets made from teeth and human jaws. Like, what is going on? At the Harvard morgue, no less. What in the world? Anyway, at least to help us understand some of this, and hopefully lots with regards to the Morton component, our guest for today's broadcast, interesting for many reasons. He is a professional demographer, also classified as an independent scholar from Westchester, PA, Pennsylvania. He is consulting with the University of Pennsylvania's Museum of Archaeology and Anthropology. Talked about them already. His primary focus is the origins of physical anthropology in Philadelphia and Germany, 1750 to 1850, a few days before I was born. Treat to have him on the broadcast. We'll dig into some of his research and a little bit of what we've heard thus far. Joining us live, Mr. John S. Michael. Mr. Michael, you with us?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your summer Wednesday evening. For our listeners who don't understand maybe what you do as a professional demographer and independent scholar, what exactly do you do in West Pennsylvania?
Well, as a demographer, my career is mostly dealing with the census and getting information from the census and distributing it to mostly local governments to help them do land planning and other comprehensive planning for their governments. Pennsylvania, we have got a lot of municipalities here, and so they need assistance. I work for the county, and I provide them with assistance. That's how I make a living. But what I have been doing now for a number of years is I've been doing historical studies dealing with the Academy of Natural Sciences of Philadelphia, which was started in the early 1800s. And I focused mostly on Dr. Samuel George Morton, who you had mentioned and who was mentioned in your earlier reporting. I'm actually with the McNeil Center from the University of Pennsylvania. I did do some work with the Penn Museum in the past, but currently to make sure I got that straight. And so basically, Philadelphia is a great place to go to do research because the libraries here, the old libraries, are great. I've even had some of my European colleagues, comment about so many of the European libraries burned down in World War One or World War Two, when the Civil War took out a lot of libraries down south. But Philadelphia really is kind of an unknown treasure trove. So I've been doing a lot of archival history, going through documents, personal letters, and a lot of them deal with Dr. Morton and his collection of human crania, which is what he was famous for when he was alive and what he's famous for now.
Wacky, just wacky. We'll be sure to update currently with the McNeil Center, strive for accuracy. And I guess you're Southeast Pennsylvania? That's not West Pennsylvania. Westchester, that's Southeast Pennsylvania?
Westchester, about 45 minutes away from Philadelphia. So it's really in the sort of Philadelphia and suburban area.
Okay. Awesome. Are you classified as a white man?
Very much so, yeah.
Very much so, okay.
Yep.
Before I forget...
My family was here actually before the Civil War. So I think there was once an anthropologist in the 1920s at Penn or at the Smithsonian. He classified old whites and new whites. And he was saying old whites were ones who were here before the Civil War. So I fall into that category.
Old whites, fascinating. Even that now. Didn't last week we have Scandinavians in Chicago talking about the Nordic stock migrating here and all of fascinating. Before we transition off to Dr. Morton and your research, just with those libraries, I'm someone who encourages folks to research, and I found your work going to the library. I said, John J. Audubon, I went to the library even when I'm on trips and vacationing. I still go visit the library. What's so special about those old libraries out in Philadelphia?
Well, part of it is Philadelphia was a center for medical education going back to Revolutionary War times. To the north, it was so cold you couldn't do a lot of work in the summer, in the wintertime. And in the south, you had yellow fever. So Philadelphia was this kind of this perfect zone where you could continue to do business in the winter and in the summer, although yellow fever would sometimes impact it. It was a lot safer. And so a lot of businesses formed here, and Philadelphia became kind of the premier economic center for the United States, kind of like what New York is now. So there was a lot of money, and there were a lot of wealthy people, and so they started hospitals and libraries, and the American Philosophical Society was started by Benjamin Franklin, who again is one of these very commercial-minded people. So the libraries here were just very well-funded early on, and it was a port city. So this money from America, they would buy documents from Europe and ship them over here. And really what happened was once things shifted. Politically, Washington, D.C. became more powerful in the late 1800s and 20th century. New York became the economic power, and these Philadelphia libraries, they almost became frozen in time. But they also have things like letters, the correspondences of Morton and other people, and I believe there's quite a bit of Audubon's work here, too, where these people, when they died, would donate their personal letters. So you don't just have the, you know, the publications, the meeting minutes from the American Philosophical Society, you also have the personal letters from these people. And that is just, you know, amazing to go through and see, here's what they wrote in their publications. Here's what they wrote to their friends, and to see, you know, when those things are consistent and when they are not.
Fascinating, fascinating. Spoken like a scholar. All righty. Let's get our go to the lab. I guess for people that are in the Philadelphia area, maybe if you go there for a trip or a vacation, swing by the library, see if you can hang out for an hour or three, maybe go through special collections, what have you, take a little tour. Maybe you can make two trips if you are going to be there long enough, but visit the libraries. Reading, way more important than watching television, streaming, Netflix, all that. You can do that on the plane on the way back. Okie doke. Let's get to our definitions, then we can have our go at Dr. Morton and all the rest of it. Great for Philadelphia. This program, I use the term racism and the term white supremacy as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
I would say what the term that I tend to use, because I'm dealing with both the past and the present, I tend to use race supremacy. And the definition of white, the problem with that for me is that it has changed throughout time. And so, like Morton, good example of Morton. Morton was a
Hang on a second, because we are going to talk about him. And I have that written down specifically, but this is something I ask all of our guests just to make sure we get this nailed down first. So if you don't think it's accurate, you can let us know that. You know, whatever, if you think there are anything that's inaccurate or if there's anything false about it, let us know. But we want to make sure that we make sure we get a precise answer to this one. So I'll give it to you again. You can let us know. Racism.
Yeah.
White supremacy. The definition I use: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Does such a system exist? Is that definition accurate?
I would say the white supremacism, I would say what you're saying about white supremacism is correct. More broadly define racism, that white supremacism is a form of racism. So I don't see them as being exactly equal.
Yeah,
I would say racism encompasses more than just white supremacy.
Okay. Racism encompasses more than white supremacy. Okay.
Yeah.
I want to make sure I point out for listeners, I did not say white supremacism. Just words are very important. Racism, white supremacy, I say they are one in the same. And you say that racism encompasses more than white supremacy. What additionally does racism to you encompass that is beyond the scope of white supremacy to you?
I would say the caste system in South Asia. So okay. That would be, and then, yeah, and there's also what some people call, that in China, there's, you know, Han supremacists, who would be racist. So, that's why I'd put a broader perspective on it.
I see. Let's ask this. Do any non-white people practice racism against white people?
I would say that there are some white people who practice racism against other white people.
Let's ask the question again. So are there non-white people who practice racism against white people?
I'm trying to think of an example, and right off the bat, I can't think of any.
Okay, no problem.
I'm very much a skeptic. That's pretty much of everybody I can think of. So yeah, I can't think of any off the bat.
Okay,
but there's all kinds of places in the world that I have not been to yet. So I don't want to claim to have an authority to talk about that. When my read of history is that there is so much of abuse of people in power against people who don't have power that,
we went afield of the question there. That's kind of important, too, because sometimes people drift way afar from the questions. And all right, so you said no examples of non-white people practicing racism against white people. Has a non-white person ever practiced racism against you personally, Mr. Michael?
A non-white person? Not that I can think of.
Okay. Okay. Got much obliged. Thank you for your honesty there. We'll just keep that in mind that he did not agree with my definition of white supremacy racism. We'll just keep that in mind as we proceed with the conversation. Okie dokie. I have to come back to that later. Before we get to Dr. Morton, I'm intrigued because you are an independent scholar in doing a lot of this research. I'm intrigued. How did you get involved? How did you become so serious about this to be an independent scholar with this particular line of research?
When I was in college, so it's almost 30 years ago, I was a geology major, and I had an internship at the fossil casting lab at the Penn Museum. And I did that one January, and I didn't go to Penn. I went to McAllister College in St. Paul, but we had this month off. And across the room from the fossil casting lab was the Morton skulls. And a bunch of other part of the human remains, the collection they had there, which was in the museum. I forget exactly. It was associated with the anthropology department. And when I was there, for some reason, we were looking for something. I was doing some curatorial work in the Morton collection. And one of the staff there said that a Harvard professor, Stephen Jay Gould, had written a paper about Morton. But Gould had never actually looked at the skulls, and that Gould had claimed that Morton had mismeasured the skulls. And so I forget whether it was me or who it was said, well, somebody should remeasure the skulls just to, you know, back check Gould. Gould claims that Morton actually mismeasured them. So the next year I went back and I remeasured the skulls. And I ended up publishing that paper. What I found was that Morton, his measurements seemed to be relatively accurate. They weren't perfect, but I couldn't find any evidence that he had consciously or subconsciously mismeasured the skulls, which was what the charge was against him. But what I did find was that he was making arbitrary classifications of people. He basically determined what was white, what was black, what was, and I should also say, I'm going to be using a lot of terms that were old fashioned terms, you know, these archaic terms that he used. I'll be using modern terms. I know people get uncomfortable with that, but if people are uncomfortable with that, that's probably good because that means people have empathy. This is some pretty horrible stuff we're talking about. So Morton, he made all kinds of errors. And so that was what I pointed out, was that just the assumption that races exist as separate and distinct categories is not biologically, it's not the way human beings exist. So that was his key flaw. So for me, the fact that he measured them, you know, there were so many other fatal flaws with his work. And I published it, and I went to graduate school but dropped out, and then I took a different career path, and I had no idea that anybody was interested in my paper until about 25 years later. Nobody contacted me. I didn't hear anything, where there was an article in the New York Times saying that someone else had remeasured the skulls and more or less come to the same conclusion that I did. You can fault Morton for many things, but he did an okay job of measuring the skulls. What I didn't know was during that period, my research had been sort of hijacked by white supremacists. There was a webpage called stormfront.org, and they took pieces, snippets of my paper, and they said that I was supporting Gould, or I was supporting Morton, because I said his measurements were right. I wasn't. I said his measurements were right, but so many of the other things that he did were just so incorrect, scientifically incorrect. And I was quoted in a book by a guy named Rushton, Philip Rushton, who was known to be a sort of an IQ supremacist. He was a Canadian guy. I was cited in the book The Bell Curve. I'm a footnote in The Bell Curve. And it was pretty embarrassing for me at the time, because I was working for a branch of government, and one of the elected officials was black. And so I had to go to my boss and explain to them, you know, I'm being celebrated by white supremacists, and they have taken my work and they have chopped it up and, misrepresented me. That got me interested in looking at my old notes. I started searching a little bit more, found these libraries in Philadelphia, and I just kept on going from there. So it's kind of a second career for me.
Wow. That is, I don't know what to say. I think I could go back in my email and find I attempted to interview Philip Rushton. I have to go back to verify, but I'm, wow, that is stunning for so many. If anything, one, anything related to racism, white supremacy, if you're talking about it, writing about it, social media, take it seriously. Wow, you have no idea who could be looking at your work, following up on it. Hopefully they don't cherry pick aspects of what you did and try and misrepresent your views. But wow, take it seriously. You have no idea. Even you might come back and, wow, I need to do some more research on this some 30 years later. Wow, that's stunning for so many reasons. I guess also what you have access to, being in an environment where you have this sort of, wow, library access, museum access right there, where this is what you're looking at every day. Wow, maybe I'll go and remeasure. Yeah. As opposed to if you don't have access to that and you're looking at, I don't know, liquor store or overpass, I don't know, something other than a library, something less constructive, maybe you don't do that paper. But that is so fat. Even your work being cherry picked by these white supremacists, that's such a key aspect of all of this anyway, going to cherry pick what we want. And I should, for people who don't know, that's being very selective, as opposed to you present all of the information that you find. You just go and you maybe pick out one or two aspects that support a very limited viewpoint that you have. You leave everything else that maybe discounts that viewpoint. There's so much of that in this pseudoscience of racism and phrenology and craniology and all the rest of it that boils down to the bell. Oh my God. For people, Adam, I'm not even sure how you would explain to people who are listeners who are under 25 who have never heard of bell curve. What is the, I guess if I had to, the most simple terms possible, the bell curve, white people are really, really smart and black people are really, really dumb, and it's genetic and there's nothing that can be done about it. Is that kind of an accurate summation of the bell curve?
That's a pretty accurate summation of the bell curve. It's a really thick book. But yeah, that's an accurate summation. Is they were taking this hereditarian, as they call it, versus environmentalist. Hereditarian means you inherit it. Environmentalist means that your intellect is shaped by the environment. And they were promoting this, you know, in the modern age, and it was a Harvard professor. And, I look at that book, I went through the book, and the citations, a lot of the citations are of people like Rushton. I kind of stumbled into this minefield. You know, growing up, I lived in when I was a little kid, my parents were from the Midwest. I'm, you know, mostly, you know, German and English and Irish and Dutch. And I grew up in an Italian neighborhood, and then I grew up in a Jewish neighborhood and a Korean neighborhood. So, I mean, I know, you know, Philadelphia, you're around all kinds of people. It's got a huge black population. So I had a sense. I was kind of like the Sesame Street generation, if you will. You know, I grew up with that. Probably one of the first people to grow up in an integrated community. You know, the people younger than me, they just didn't exist because of redlining. And then to have all this come out and to find myself praised, there was one quote that I was writing a paper that was critical of Stephen Jay Gould, who was a left-leaning Jewish scholar from Harvard, of which there are many. And it said, undergraduate, it was me, they said, the headline was, undergraduate disproves Pinko Commie Jew. You know, that was, they were hailing me with that headline. My sister's married Jewish people. I grew up in a Jewish neighborhood. So it was hitting close to home.
Wow. Context of White Supremacy. He already told us. He said, hey, white people practice racism against other white people. Yes, they do. I guess getting more to this specific body of research that has been cherry-picked and all the rest of it. Wow, you used the term before, and you even told us, hey, some of these terms are kind of antiquated, and I think they negroid and all that sort of thing from way back when. Some people even still use those type terms. Got all that. One of the terms from way back then, race supremacist, and specifically, you write Anglo-Saxons who by his definition, Morton, included Englishmen, Germans, Scandinavians, and Scots, but not what he called the Celts. He held that most unsophisticated Celts were of Southwest Ireland, whose wild look and manner recalled the memory of a barbarous age. What a quote. Morton was not exactly a white supremacist, in quotes, akin to the modern post-Civil War usage of the term, because he did not view all white European nationalities as possessing racial superiority. I thought that was really important to kind of helping us understand who this guy, Dr. Samuel Morton, is. So just for listeners, I'm sure we have folks, this is their first time hearing from him. Can you kind of give us a little bit more detail, the difference, race supremacist, white supremacist, for this time period, 19th century, for Dr. Morton?
Yeah. Well, he would be what we would now call a racist. Now, the term racism started in the late 1800s and really only came into use around with the rise of the Nazis. So racism is a relatively recent term. One of the things you want to do when you study historical figures is you don't want to judge them, in a sense, by today's standards. You want to understand what they were thinking at their time. And so it's for historians, it's just a problem. You can't ever solve this thing. I refer to him as a race supremacist because that's what the term was used when he was around. And so I'm almost like the ACLU. I'm trying to be fair to people who I really don't like. But I don't want to candy coat anything, and I want to present this is the way he thought. And so that's the term I use. There was a school of racism. There is many forms of racism. There was one book by a guy, he wrote Racisms. There's almost like flavors of them. And so, Morton was of the, Anglo-Saxonist school, if you will, of racists, race supremacists, where it was the belief that Germanic peoples and Scandinavian peoples were superior to Irish people, Celtic people, sometimes Scottish people. In certain parts of Germany, they thought the Slavic people, the Russian people, were inferior. There was a German scholar named Miners who wrote these articles in the late 1700s saying how the Negroes of North America are so similar to, in many ways, to the Russians, and that they are inferior in specific ways. So for Morton, he would have viewed certain whites as being more superior than other whites. He also viewed certain black Africans as being more superior. In some of his writings, he talks about the Zula, who are the Zulu. And he says, I have heard that there are these Africans who have kings and are very civilized in the southern part of Africa, but I don't know very much about them, but they seem to be more superior to like the West Africans, the people, the majority of the American slaves came from that population. He also said among Native Americans that the Aztecs and the Peruvians who had this great cities of Mexico and Peru, that they were superior to what he called the barbarous tribes. So for him, that was like this multi-layered, layer upon layer, which I think today, you know, people don't view it that way today. But I think it's important to know that he did. And so that's the thing where I struggle with what the right term to use to describe him. For me, I use race supremacist. But the nuances of just his theories were different than like kind of your standard white supremacist neo-Nazi today.
Context of white supremacy. I just want to point out for listeners, because he said white supremacist neo-Nazi, and that's a term that I have not used. When I say system of white supremacy racism or a white person who is practicing racism, white supremacy, I do not mean the Klan or neo-Nazis. I mean typical, everyday, kind of like the folks that we're talking about, Dr. Morton. These are doctors. These are not white, toothless white people who are ignorant and never went to school. These are doctors, physicians. These are the people that are responsible for eugenics. And it just continues all the way through bell curve, Lothrop Stoddard. These folks are not neo-Nazis and just wild, barbarous white people. These are people who scientifically go about the business of maintaining, practicing, refining white supremacy racism. Very important. With regards to the rest of your response, wow, the different ways of practicing racism, white supremacy, absolutely. And even I thought it was so delectable, Negro, he said different flavors of racism. although for me, going back to the definition where I think you did not agree, in my view, that is white supremacy racism, because the hierarchy is so common. Adolf Hitler had that same sort of hierarchy, the Aryans, we are the supreme, like even amongst the white people, I got to divvy it up. That is so, just last week, Dr. Erica K. Jackson, Scandinavians, she talked about, you got the Irish, wild, barbarous. Many white people still thought that way, even early part of the 1900s, late 1900s, early 20th century. Many white people still thought that way about so-called white people from Ireland. Not so about Scandinavians. We talked about that in detail. Hierarchy, just meaning you have some white people who are more powerful than other white people, and it just continues all the way through the spectrum. Some non-white people. But generally, that's what I was going to ask, amongst all these different flavors of white supremacy racism, is it generally, if not unanimously, the dark people at the bottom? Is that always what happens with these different flavors?
It does seem to be that way. And that is one thing. I think you and I are arguing over semantics here. What I think a good point that you made, which I also like to make, is that there is the, I think, this view of like Klansmen and neo-Nazis and violent racists, that you have to be one of these violent, militaristic racists to be a racist. No, you don't. And the notion that's the systemic notion of it, which, you know, Frederick Douglass was talking about that way before anybody else was, he was talking about the slave system and how it affects all kinds of people and how it affects the society as a whole. That I think Morton is actually a really good example of this, because Morton, when you read what Morton writes, he never uses ethnic slurs. He's very polite. He's very scholarly. By all accounts, he was a very nice guy. Everybody got along with him, unlike Audubon, who I believe like had a terrible personality, as I recall. But yeah, so Morton was not some guy who was going to be chanting and, you know, marching and behaving like a, you know, a Klansman or a Nazi or something like that. He was a very genteel guy. He was a very polite guy. And yet these were his beliefs. He was very strong, having a hierarchy of people, a hierarchy of intelligence. And, you know, if you met him, probably be the nicest guy, a very polite guy who wouldn't use insulting terms, because that would be beneath him, because he was a gentleman. And that, to me, it's like there's this gentlemanly racism, and people, you know, we don't think about that so much today. You know, our stereotype of what a racist is, you know, some guy in a hood or with swastikas. And that was not the way it was back then. And in many respects, it probably isn't that way today. So I think your point is good. And Morton is really an example of that. And sometimes I have difficulty talking to people and saying, no, he was in many respects a polite, nice guy. Everybody liked him. And yet the things that he would say in his letters in a very, very scholarly manner, he would talk about the Irish, and he would talk about, the inherent moral, not just intellectual, moral and sometimes physical inequality with mostly West African people. And then he would also pick, like, I think the Shoshones. For some reason, he said the Shoshones were this completely animalistic tribe. But then the Aztecs, he thought, you know, that there was something above that. I often wondered if I could talk to him, I would say, who you say that, like, the West Africans are beneath the Zulus and the Irish are beneath the Germanic peoples. Where do the Irish and the West Africans, where do they rank? You know, he didn't address that, but it's kind of like, yeah, you know, where would you put these people?
Somewhere beneath the superior white people. Somewhere beneath the superior whites. In the report, about Philadelphia, I thought this was important because we've talked about Henrietta Lacks, and we talked about some of the other, Virginia's Medical College, the Coon Man, former governor, some of the areas where there was a large population of black people. In fact, Dr. Utsi talked about that, where he was talking about Virginia specifically, but he said this was a national problem with regards to grave robbing black people. I said areas where you have lots of or a large concentration of black people, probably going to be a big problem in this time period, talking about the 1800s. You write, this is in your report, An American Humble. This is about Dr. Morton, about Philadelphia specifically. Philadelphia was also a central hub for the sale of corpses used for medical school dissections, many of whom were deceased slaves. That is not something that I would immediately think about for the city of brotherly love, but there are a lot of black people there. Is this something that's widely known?
Well, you had mentioned The Price for a Pound of Their Flesh by Diana Rainey Barry, that book. That book is fantastic, and I don't think it's gotten enough press. Her scholarship, I met her at a conference back. It's like airtight. She really has got the, you know, the citations. I'm a skeptic. I want to see something and multiple sources say that it's true. And basically she tells the story of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, this big medical center, very Quaker heritage, and yet they needed bodies. They needed bodies for, for dissection. And what her point was, if you were enslaved, somebody owned you while you were alive. Once you died, they still own you. And they could sell your body parts. And that's really what she documented so well. It's the system of slavery. If you are not, you know, you're not a slave state, but still you're benefiting from it in one way or another. It's just like Northern Mills, where they were pious anti-slavery people. It still takes a cotton from the South and mill it. And sort of in the same way, these Quaker medical men in Philadelphia, they'd still take the bodies of enslaved people, and because they could get them. It became a commodity. So that is, you know, that's a reality. When you look at the Morton collection of crania, there are, most of the crania are Native Americans who would have just been, in a sense, grave robbed. I suppose I could come up with a more accurate term from that, but people would find their skeletons, for the African American or the, I guess, Afro-American, which is, you come into difficult terms, the population, the kind of the slave caste Americans, African Americans born in America into slavery, some of them freed. There were some of those in the Morton collection. And I suspect from what I can see, most of them were just poor people who then were in a hospital, a public hospital, maybe died and were put in the pauper's field, and there was really nobody to protect them. And so they dug them up. That's my sense. Some of the skulls, I've just completed a study on a number of skulls that came from Cuba and were probably African-born, enslaved in Africa, shipped over to Cuba, and died soon after. And again, they had nobody to protect them, and ultimately their skulls were sent to Morton. And then among the white and the European population, you had things like soldiers who died died in a war in the Bloody Pond. There was Battle of Bloody Pond. And those were the lowest rungs of European society as well. He had a woman he called a fille de joie, which is a prostitute. And that was one of his white skulls. So his skulls were taken from the lowest castes of society, people who had no one looking out for them. That's something that's really consistent. People who are wealthy and have a nice tomb, they tended not to end up in medical collections. It's kind of one of these unpleasant, but that is the way things function then.
I don't know how much has changed. I'm looking, this is one I'm pulling out, micro, macro, and I'm looking at this over generations, long period of time. This seems to be a big pattern with regards to how individuals classified as white conduct themselves. All of this trafficking, Dana Ramey Berry, you talked about her amazing scholarship there, Pound of Flesh. Everyone, they could put that on your summer read list. There you go. But she documents this. I said just this year we had Dr. Sean Utsi on the program. He has two fantastic documentaries. Now, they're Virginia-focused, but he says in the films, and he said speaking with us, this was widespread. This was not just the Commonwealth of VA. This was, hey, if you got a population of black people, just as you said, lowest rung, back of the boat, bottom of the rung, psh, no one to protect. Buddy, you had better hope you die in the summertime. But pulling out and looking at this from the big picture, man, so this is widespread happening to slaves throughout. Harriet A. Washington talked about this. This continues. That's Dr. Utsi's work. This continues even after slavery. We still need bodies for the med school and whatever else. I played the clip about MOVE. Their remains being hidden, put that in quotes, for decades. We talked about Robert Berdella, serial killer in the Kansas City area. He had an oddity shop with heads and skulls and all these other human parts on display, and then he's killing people. We heard the report about the Harvard morgue that's right now selling body parts and trafficking skin being tanned and skulls and all the rest of this. And then even when I remember, oh dang, with the Klan, we want to go back to that, when they would do the lynchings so frequently, it's, we got to castrate the body. Even Zachariah Walker lynched right there in Pennsylvania. Worthless Negro from Virginia lynched right there in Coatesville, PA. They detailed, we got to go castrate him, take some of his knuckles and put it in a jar. This seems to be an enormous component of white culture. In fact, when I think that way, then I'm not stunned that Jeffrey Dahmer is a celebrity, that he would have the smash hit Netflix of all time doing kind of the same sort of thing. Do you see, or am I making sense? Is this a larger pattern of conduct with regards to individuals who classify themselves as white?
One of the things that I don't want to do is, my expertise is Morton, and there are a lot of people who have written about race who are what they call a false authority. People who claim to have an expertise in an area they don't. This is rife in the history of racial scholarship. The guy named Vary in France wrote about race and skull shape and all this stuff. He was a pharmacist. James Hunt is a guy, founded the race supremacist, it was the Anthropological Society of London. He was a speech pathologist. Even people like Stephen Jay Gould, who wrote Mismeasure of Man, he was his specialty was snails. And for me, especially as a white guy with that legacy, I'm not going to fall into that trap. So what I can say is that when I look at Morton's stuff, and then I look at the stuff like Professor Berry wrote, and then I look at what's going on today, and it just seems like, here we go again. That was my when I first found out about all this MOVE stuff. Here we go again. That's what it seems. Is there a direct line connecting Morton to what was going on at the Penn Museum? If Morton didn't exist, a lot of the stuff would be going on anyway. Again, it's the system. It's the systemic part of it. It does seem like, you know, we have this system, which, again, I'm of the follower of Frederick Douglass. It's the slave system that just turned into a greater system. And yeah, I mean, it's like a legacy. It's a legacy that we can't shake. I almost feel like it's more like you gotta accept that you're an alcoholic rather than saying, I'm going to be pure of this problem. And we can't candy coat it. We got to accept that that's a foundation of this country. And I will not be surprised if we see more stuff like this happen or we discover more stuff like this happen.
When you say stuff like this, you mean the misuse of these corpses and body parts?
Right. Where there was one where they found, I forget where it was, some museum had a diorama and it actually had a human skull in it, and it was like some Native American. Mm. And they had just used his skull. I have no doubt that more things like this will come up. And in America, we will find that historically that there are black and brown bodies that are being used as parts, that are being stored somewhere that nobody knew that they were there. And I suspect that in Europe, you'll find that it might be Russians or it might be Irishmen. And in India, you'll find that it's low caste people. I have no doubt that that's going to continue. I don't claim to have the solution. Again, I don't want to claim to have an authority that I don't have, but yeah.
Okay. Going on a tangent a little bit.
What's going on?
We got it. We got it. Thank you. John S. Michael, much obliged. I do want to point out the metaphors. Wow. Did they pile up in response to that question just about the patterns, with regards to white conduct and grave robbing? You can let us know if you think of a more accurate term than grave robbing, theft of corpses, and robbing of cemeteries and such. The metaphors, I just wanted to point out, one is not a metaphor per se, but this is just a different pattern of conduct, individuals classified as white. He said he follows Frederick Douglass. I've said for years white people will quote non-white people about racism, white supremacy, and most of the time it is something inaccurate, which is not surprising. Non-white people, we are still learning, trying to figure all of this out, snickering. I don't think anything is funny about that or the legacy of Mr. Douglas, cowbell. Now, the metaphors, he said, we have to, I think he was talking about racism, that we have to admit that this just is something that we can't shake. Metaphor. Then he said it's like alcoholism. You have to accept that you're an alcoholic. And then he meant immediately to, we can't candy coat. I just said, wow, that is just rapid fire of metaphors. I point that out frequently, especially when white people are seeming like they don't want to respond to a question or what have you, and they'll just pepper you with a lot of metaphors. Be mindful, alert for that sort of thing. Specifically with the chuckling again. I agree with you. Well, hang on. I want to get to my question because you're interrupting. You interrupted. I'll give you a chance to respond. It shouldn't be anything that vociferous if we're in agreement then. I wanted to get to the American Humboldt report specifically. This one I found fascinating for a lot of reasons. I don't want to get, I guess, into the minutiae about the... I don't want to get into the minutiae about all the different white people who eulogized him, although that is fascinating, just trying to pick out, you know, who was kind of with him and who was not with him. What I did find fascinating about this, number one, you talk about Charles Darwin, again, putting him proper place and time period, still alive. It seems that Charles Darwin is not a fan of Dr. Morton, and it's not necessarily about the racism. It's, hey, this guy is not being a quality scientist. Did I read that correctly?
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. Can we get some detail?
I think the point of that was there are people in the 20th century and people now who say that Morton was universally hailed as the objectivist, the empirical scientist of his day. and that Morton is a good example of how scientists can be racially biased despite being dedicated to facts and figures. What I found was that there were a lot of scholars, a lot of people, who thought Morton's research was poorly done. And myself, the research I did a while back, he was terrible at math. His work was just sloppy. But it's just to get the perspective of the man, if we're going to use somebody and say this person is an example of a racist scientist, he's not a good example of that. It's picayune. It's nitpicking. But that's what historians do. I mean, that's what we do. We nitpick on little facts. And that was the thing where it just seemed to me as though that people claimed he was a Quaker. He was an Episcopalian. If you're going to do something like this, do your homework. And that was the thing where Morton was not universally celebrated. And some very big players like Darwin thought that he did second-rate work. Now, what's significant about that, it also is people like Josiah Nott, who was very influential in promoting race supremacy in the U.S. Census, among other things. He promoted Morton's work and said, this guy's a great scientist, and so you should believe what he says. And that was almost like a PR campaign by Josiah Nott after Morton had died. So again, I'm a skeptic. Don't believe, you read something, you read what Josiah Nott said, and then you say, well, who is Josiah Nott? How would he benefit by saying that he was good friends with a fine scientist who supported racism and polygenism, the notion that each race was separately created or was a separate species? It was kind of a PR machine. And we in the modern era, we have to be skeptical of what people were saying in the past. That was really one of the main aspects of my paper, that you can't believe everything that was said in the past. And so these people, even today, who say, well, Morton's work was actually correct, Morton was a great scientist, and white supremacist now. No, he wasn't. A lot of it was just like a PR campaign.
Nobody does PR campaigns better than the system of white supremacy racism. Revisit an earlier topic, best seller, New York Times, The Bell Curve. Nobody does PR better than the system of white supremacy racism, individuals classified as white. With Charles Darwin, it struck me for so many reasons. We're reading Columbine in our book club. Be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. And Charles Darwin has come up in our Columbine study in such an important manner. I don't know if you don't want to ask you to speak outside your field of interest, but I don't know. Are you familiar with Columbine? Are you old enough to where that was something for you, an event for you?
Oh, I know about the Columbine shooting.
Right.
Yeah, I'm aware of that.
Okay. The two cowardly white shooters in that case, one of them, his T-shirt, natural selection, that's what it had written on the front of it the day of the shooting. And in his journals, he talks about Darwin and natural selection repeatedly as a part of his motivation for this attack. He was totally with the idea of the hierarchy, and I'm at the top. They're white, so we are at the top of the hierarchy. In fact, we're gods, and everybody else is beneath us, and that's why a major part of the ideology of why they wanted to go to do this. But talk about thinking that I even had to go back and read the full title again, On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection or the Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. full title for Darwin's book, but man, I mean, these ideas, talking about how the bell curve and all of that, how these ideas can, that's not one day like your paper 30 years later and it still has relevance. These ideas, particularly the ones that relate to white supremacy, racism, wow, they have extraordinary shelf life. Just any thoughts? I don't want to get you to go too far afield, but yeah, he had, that's well documented. That's on his shirt, natural selection, the day of the massacre.
That, well, actually, the first thought that came to me was, I didn't know that, that when Charles Darwin was using the term race, he may have been, if you look at dictionaries, you can go online on Google and you can look up the word race and see how it is defined going back in time, especially through the 1800s. I don't know where Darwin would have been placed with that. But in the early 1800s, race kind of means your lineage or your nationality, not necessarily this continental thing. And then as the 19th century moves on, it becomes more to what we are thinking about it. And that was, again, me being a skeptic and looking at these old documents. But clearly this shooter, seems to be, you know, interested in this notion of like, survival of the fittest sort of stuff, which was actually not, I believe Darwin didn't come up with that phrase. I think his cousin did, Galton. But it's just interesting. People will take a term that meant something maybe slightly different or rather different in the past. They'll latch onto it, and it just becomes like almost like an article of faith, where that this is what they believe. And for me as a historian trying to tie that to what Darwin is, and I'm like, well, Darwin may have used it differently. It's frustrating. It drives me nuts. But yeah, it's the read of history is often so simplistic, and it's not nuanced. It's just the nature of, I guess, the way things are these days.
That, I guess, is a problem for many, or has been a problem frequently many years. But I think it's important how many generations of racists have found use of Darwin's work and theories, and even how that was used to justify a lot of the later eugenics scientists, Eric Harris, and on and on and on and on for generations. Wow. But back to Mr. Josiah Knott, because you talked about his impact on the census, which I thought was amazing. In fact, maybe you can share a little bit. I just want to read a snippet from, this is a separate report of yours. So this one is the Bias Brings and Skulls Tracing the Legacy of Scientific Racism in the 19th Century Works of Samuel George Morton and Friedrich Tiedemann. Did I say it correctly? Tiedemann?
Yeah, Frederick Tiedemann, yeah.
Tiedemann, gotcha. Got these wacky names for these folks. Okay, back to Josiah Clark Knott and how he impacted the census. I'll read this paragraph really quick. You write, Morton also maintained close relationships with some of America's most outspoken race supremacists, I'd say white supremacists, but same deal, including anatomist Charles Caldwell, whose thoughts on the original unity of the human race has been described as the first explicitly polygenist book written in English. That's basically people descended, there are many different the genesis of people is varied. We did not all come from the same person, Adam and Eve, or anything like that. Like white people over here, that's our genesis, and the non-white people, they're, you know, over here in the shed or wherever. But we did not all come from the same person. That's polygenist. So it continues. Morton was also a friend and colleague of Josiah Clark Knott, 1804 to 1873, a Paris-trained surgeon, an Alabama plantation owner, a vocal white supremacist, not gained notoriety as a popular lecturer on what he called niggerology. Oh, unbelievable. Arguing that the Negro attains his greatest perfection, physical and moral, and his greatest longevity in a state of slavery, end quote. After Morton's death, not compiled, the types of mankind, arguably the most extensive statement of polygenism and pre-Darwinian scientific racism. The book's dedication was to the memory of Morton and included posthumous publication of Morton's unfinished manuscripts given to Knott by Morton's widow. Knott's co-author was another of Morton's virulently race supremacist colleagues, Egyptologist, George Glidden. In the 1840s, Morton had also befriended Louise Agassiz, the Swiss-born naturalist and influential Harvard, again, professor of natural history, who had shifted from an egalitarian position to one of polygenism and white superiority after moving from Europe to the United States. Just for a little context, now since you work with the census and what have you, demographer, how did Josiah Clark Knott impact the U.S. Census?
This I've done some reading on, so I would say it is my understanding that when the census started, really what they were looking into was three categories. Are you a slave? Are you a white landowner? Or are you a white tenant? And if you were a landowner, then you could vote if you owned a certain amount of land. And that was in a way, that was not what we would call race entirely, because it was sort of like your class standing. And then as time went on, they changed, even before emancipation, they changed the slave into, what did they turn it into? It kept going back and forth. I thought it was Negro for a while, and then the two white categories, tenant and landlords, got merged into just white. And then they started to count Native Americans, who they had as Indian. And then at some point, they started adding mulatto. And that was done. My understanding is Josiah Knott, had this theory. Josiah Knott was what I would call a white supremacist. He thought the Irish were okay, and that Europeans were one massive group and all Africans were one massive group. So he didn't make the distinctions that Morton did. But what Knott thought was that mixing of the races was very detrimental. And he believed that if you had that people of mixed African and European ancestry would be weaker, would be less likely to produce children, would be mentally more feeble. So he thought, in a way, mulattoes, it's the term that he would use, right, that he would use, he was using, were actually even worse off than Africans. So what he wanted to do is he wanted to get some statistics on it. So he wanted to get the government to start gathering statistics on not just slave caste, African, black, Negro, colored, call them what you will, and white, who always are called white, interestingly enough. He wanted to know about mixtures so he could get some information on them, because it was his theory that you could prove that mixing races produced a more enfeebled part, an enfeebled form of person. He did influence the census to start gathering information like that, but it didn't last very long. Why exactly they didn't continue with it could have been just simply administrative. So he was, he was an important player and knew a lot of people. And the ironic part was, when you read the stuff that he wrote about infectious diseases, the guy was brilliant. You know, he was, again, one of these gentlemen. The quote that you gave is something that everybody quotes, but you read his letters, he is a witty, intelligent guy. And were it not for his, like, over-the-top, stone-cold racism, he puts Morton to shame, he probably would have been remembered as a really good surgeon and somebody who investigated yellow fever and other things. Fascinating character. There's a great book about him by a guy named Reginald Horseman, which is, again, put that on your reading list. He was very influential. I almost feel like Knott was more influential than Morton was, because Knott spread the word. He was good at giving speeches and spreading the word.
Niggerology. Hey, got to inform people. Let them know the dangers. That is amazing.
Yeah, no, but that was the way he approached it. That was the way he approached it. Morton was quiet, but Knott was like a salesman.
What is he selling? Niggerology. Gotta keep an eye on that. Stay away from them. Can't be jumping in bed and going crazy. Niggerology. That is I've got that. Add that to the summer reading list. I love the biographies. Reading more important than watching television. Reginald Foreman biography on Josiah Knott. Duly noted. Okay. And even the census, talk about that. Racial classifications are so important. And even what he said, white people, white. They don't do all that breaking it up and, you know, European white and Irish. White. And at the time, is that the case? Have you noted that when you look back at the census records over, I don't know, at this point, centuries, white is at the top when they go to put these forms out? Is that what you've seen consistently?
Yep. That one is... Actually, the first one, I think they listed slave first. The census has got an interesting web page where they show the changes in the categories. It's called crosswalks, where they change the terms and over time. And it's a political document. I mean, they're doing this all for political reasons. So you don't need to look at it and say, like, oh, what are they trying to say, you know, scientifically? It's a political document. And it starts off with just three classifications. They don't even really call them anything. They don't call them race. They just say, here are the three groups that we're interested in. Slaves, tenant whites, and landowning whites. And then it kind of merges into this thing where, well, slave basically means black, right? I mean, and so then they change it into that, and it flips back and forth. There's a lot of good books about, you know, the census and how they deal with race, too, that have come out in recent years. But it's not entirely clear. I've often tried to figure out how that relates to the work Morton was doing and whether Morton influenced them. And I've never been able to find a real direct correlation, a direct link with Morton, but with Knott, a lot more of that has been documented.
Stunning. And he said it seems like they got that corrected pretty quickly, and white, and we should be at the top. Yes, white. Not even alphabetical. That doesn't matter. White at the top.
Well, and and that's the thing, is so many of these things are always alphabetical, but
not that one.
that's a problem with the statistical analysis. And when you're, you know, this whole notion of systemic racism is we're dealing with data sets that are repeated every 10 years, and we started a long time ago. And it's like you can't just say we're going to alphabetize these things. There's administrative, it gets locked into the administration. It's nobody consciously saying, oh yeah, we want to put whites at top. It's just, that's the way the forms are. If you want to do historic research and you're taking it back in time, you have no option. But yeah, it's, It's pretty crazy. And the Census Bureau, they're really good people. I've been very impressed with the Census, and they're aware of all this.
Oh, I'm sure they are. They are.
They have a pretty. they're pretty good at trying to address these issues and these inequities and try to come up with ways that they can go forward, because they really do want to count everybody. And if they alienate people, they're not going to have people cooperate.
Mm. Yeah. I will submit that it's so common that we hear that as justification for white supremacy racism, that it's legacy or it's institutions. It's crazy that was even used. It's locked in. What all of that goes back to is my definition, that word dedication, because I've seen where individuals classified as white, they make all kinds of updates. My phone nags me every 5 minutes about updates. They update and change and refine that word again all the time. That doesn't even make sense, that racism, white supremacy, the most dominant system on the planet, that one, everybody is unwitting. That doesn't make sense. I'm sure those folks are very aware, and it's not a coincidence or accident. White at the top, not African American. That could maybe Asian American. Nope, it'd be African American. Talking crazy. That is talking crazy. With what you said before, that it was slave, and somehow that just got switched to Negro, means the same thing, basically. That's something we concluded as well. And in fact, I'm switching just because of what you just said. Words, they're so important. I give out the number if folks have questions they would like to ask our guest, Mr. Michael John S. The number, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Words. Oh, my God. This report is stunning. I wish I could have read more, but I tried to read other things than just Mr. Well, that's all Mr. Morton, kind of. So this one, let's see. I studied Spanish, so I feel like I should at least try this. Let's see. Vedado donde no se entierran más que negros. Got that one. Bozales. Español, the burial grounds of 55 enslaved Africans whose skulls were acquired, even that were acquired, by S.G. Morton, acquired. Is that the best term? Is that the most accurate term for this? Acquired?
What you're talking about there was a letter that was written in Spanish to Morton. Morton received 55 skulls of from Cuba, and those skulls were described using a Spanish word, bozales, which means roughly translated into muzzled, and it described newly arrived slaves. In English, sometimes they were called saltwater slaves, so that would be people who were born in Africa and then were enslaved in America. The Spanish that was used was a very formal type of Spanish. It's sort of antiquated. We had some difficulties translating it to figure out exactly what the guy meant. But the best we could come up was acquired, and that was kind of a vague term. Myself and a colleague are still trying to figure out and researching exactly what does that mean. From what we can tell, the skulls came from a burial ground that was really more like a pit, like a mass grave, and that they found the skulls loose, as opposed to if they had the bodies and they dissected them. Again, this is all really awful stuff, but that is the... It's interesting that you talk about that one word, and that one word really just is so central to what does acquired mean. But we think in this instance, they just found skulls that had been on the surface like a storm or something had in Cuba. They have these massive storms. They probably left these skulls sort of on the sandy soil, and that's probably where they were acquired.
Hmm.
So that on that one, and that speaks to, like you said, Audubon. Was he a grave robbing? There are some reports we see where people would be walking out in the woods and they would see bones that were buried in a hillside, but the hillside had eroded, so the bones were just there, and they just picked them up. There are other instances where people, I believe it was Glidden, who got the skulls from Egypt, where he wrote letters to Morton saying that he got these skulls, and it was very difficult because the people didn't want us disturbing their graveyards. And so sometimes these things are just found lying on the ground. Sometimes they are what would be more called robbed. And an older definition of rob is to just take something out, just to take something, like robbing stone would be going to a ruin and taking the stone away from the ruin. So yeah, there were all kinds of ways. And then some of the skulls Morton got were someone had dissected a body and took the skull out and sent it to Morton. So that acquired, that's one of these mystery words where you sit there and you go, what is it? We know what it means now. What did it mean back then? What did it mean in the context?
Acquired. You write, this is where I get back to terms. I found this part, I'll just read, folks can process themselves. So this is further down in the report about the acquisition of these Negro skulls from Cuba. As noted above, the term bozales described enslaved Africans newly arrived in the Americas. The word bozales is derived from the old Spanish word bozal, meaning muzzled or bridled, as in the case of a horse. Ooh, haven't we been talking about that Kentucky Derby? According to the 1887, I think they sold Frederick Douglass for a horse. I have to go back to double check. According to the 1887 Diccionario General Etymologico de la Lengua Española, the word bozal was defined as, I got the English, thank God, adjective, a Negro who was recently removed from his native county, metaphorical and vernacular, one who is a novice or beginner in some activity, one who is foolish or idiotic, bottom of the bell curve, can be applied to wild horses. Oh, wounded. It continues in 1840, the Scottish abolitionist and diplomat David Turnbull published Travels in the West Cuba, in which he wrote, as applied to Negroes, the term Creole and Bozal are pretty nearly antithetical. It is true that when a horse is spoken of, the phrase un caballo bozal means merely that he has not been sufficiently broken in, but it is otherwise with the poor African who is spoken of as a bozal long after he has lost all his natural spirit. The term criollo or creole is applied in Cuba, as in other islands of the West Indies, not to men and women merely, white, black, or brown, but to domestic animals in general, and even to plants. I will stop there, but wow. What? Studying words, and even around the world, wow. global system of white supremacy racism. Now, this report, again, is about how did Morgan acquire, I'm putting my air quotes up, these Negro skulls from Cuba. But you give us this extensive kind of etymological breakdown of this word bozal. Why did you think that was so important to give us all this detail, Mr. Michael?
That term, and it's pretty controversial, is one that it's important in the context of Morton. But I think just that term, that's another one where if you know the term, there's so much that comes after it. If you had to come up with that term, right, and you're part of the slave trade, and let's look at it was a term, you know, as part of the business. This was a business, and you have to look at it. That's what it was. So they had just like in, you know, with cows, you have a cow, a bull, a calf. You have all these terms. There was a series of terms that they would use for shipping human chattel. And bozales meant somebody who was newly arrived slaves. They'd be enslaved in Africa, come over here, and then they had to be, in a sense, broken in. They had to be trained how to be slaves, what to know what was expected of them, to know what would happen to them if they did the wrong thing. And because the folks who came over, they didn't know. You know, they were, a lot of them were, you know, people from, you know, rural parts of Africa who, you know, they didn't know what they were getting into. And so somebody had to show them that. And so they would have these camps. I forget what they were called. It's the Spanish term for them. And they had a lot of them in Cuba, because Cuba was in many ways like a warehouse that then they distribute to, you know, it was like a wholesale. And then you go retail, which sounds blunt and horrible, because it was. And so these bozales, they would spend, I don't know how much time in these camps, just sort of being broken in a sense, both emotionally and in a sense being trained. Let them know this is the way your life is going to be from here on out. What happened was a lot of the people who came over were from, you know, rural parts of Africa. They didn't have a lot of disease resistance. And they'd come over here and they'd be put, first they'd be packed into ships and they wouldn't have been enough food, enough water. But they, you know, they, a lot of them died on the ships, or then they'd arrive and they didn't have disease resistance, so they would die. And that was the thing with the bozales. We're getting into another paper, which if you go to my webpage, it was fascinating, really horrible, about these Cubans. Then they were dying at such a high rate that the Cuban government at the time, they didn't know what to do with all the bodies. They couldn't dump them out at sea because they just wash in ashore. And so they had these massive amounts of dead Africans. And we're still not sure how Morton found out about it, but that's what Morton wanted. He wanted Africans born in Africa, because not all of the anatomists, the race scholars, they weren't all race supremacists. Most of them were, I'd say 9 out of 10, but there was a guy, Frederick Tiedemann, who was an anatomist, and he said that the reason that some skull collections had small African skulls is because they were slaves. And he was saying, if you raise somebody as a slave, they're not going to get a good diet. They're going to be smaller and shorter, and their head's going to be smaller. So you really can't compare. If you want to really do a thorough job of this, you have to compare people born in Africa who were born in Africa and had a better diet. And that was what Morton was looking for. He had some American slave caste people, former slaves, freedmen, but he what he really wanted was indigenous, or as he, I think he called them, native born. And the place to get them was Cuba. And so that's why that term is so important, because that's specifically what he was looking for. He was specifically looking for it for a reason. It shows that his general hypothesis was that if he could get native-born Africans, he could show that their skulls were smaller. And the ironic thing was, is when he got those skulls and he measured them, they really weren't much smaller than the European skulls. So, you know, he made so much of an effort to gather those. And then after he gets them and he measures them, he doesn't really, I haven't seen where he wrote about them all that much. So, and he was trying to prove Tiedemann wrong, and I don't think he did. I think Tiedemann's views won out, but Tiedemann's views were not nearly as widely distributed as Morton's was. That's very interesting as far as the politics of the system of racism. You had scholars like Tiedemann who said, no, I don't see these big differences between races. Their studies didn't seem to get very well distributed.
That's another one. You put that on the list right next to white at the top of the census list. We take bogus, fake, talk about fake news, fake science, pseudoscientific BS, Dr. Welsing, and that's what gets promoted. You got quality white science. This is, hey, I don't see these differences. Shut up. Ah. That's not accidental. That's not a coincidence. Bell curve. What did I tell you? Bestseller. Bell curve. You're in the footnotes, Mr. Michael. See there? I'm bestseller. Got my name in a bestseller. See? And that just for, again, because I hear it so frequently. I don't know about you, Mr. Michael, but I do. I have heard it my whole life. Us Negroes, we are hardy people because we live through slavery. And anyone to go through all that, you have got to be strong. Even that's the essence of the term bozale. Your spirit has been broken. Like, wow. I mean, wow. But I hear that, and to hear your description, he was able to acquire these Negro skulls because so many people died, so many black people born on the continent died on the voyage over. And you even go into the detail about why that is and all of that, and, you know, I think lots of studies on that, but so many of them died that what are we going to do with these bodies? What are we going to do? Skulls, take them all. Here, helping us out, right? Get rid of them. Woohoo! The worthless, that nobody who will be missed. And they just dump them in a sinkhole. Black life, not a whole lot has changed, unfortunately. Let's see, Tulsa, Oklahoma. Let's see, we'll nab callers with questions as we proceed. Victim in New Jersey, did you have a question for our guest, Mr. John S. Michael? Depends, I was going to say Philadelphia, but you're not in Philadelphia. Westchester.
Close enough.
Did victim in New Jersey, did you have a question? Yes, a question for Mr. Michael. You should be with us.
Hey, how's it going? Mr. Michael, he said something. He said about the scholarship. Yesterday, he said, here we go again. We made the correlation between the bell curve and what people are coining the model minority myth as it relates to comparing Asians to black Americans, or what's even more interesting is dealing with the scholarship from yesteryear, how West Africans were considered amongst the stupider of the races. Now they're touted as being smarter than black Americans. Did you see that correlation, or is that rooted in bell curve ideology?
So I couldn't hear parts of the question. Gus, do you want to reiterate that to me?
I was struggling a tad as well. Do you think maybe you could get a little bit closer? I don't know if you're on speakerphone or not. If you could, if you're driving, be safe. But
I'm sorry, Gus. Am I coming in clearer?
That is better. Yes. Speak up a little bit. Give it to us one more time, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So what I was saying was, you said something interesting. You said, here we go again, as we talk about the scholarship from yesteryear and now. Can you make the correlation are people using bell curve ideology when they use terms like model minority, or when they're now, and you stated that the West African was deemed some of the less smarter, but now as it relates to comparison between West African immigrants and Black Americans, they're saying that they are more achieved or more smarter. Is these new ideas linked to bell curve ideology?
That's a good question. And again, that's not my expertise. But what I think I can say is when you talk about the notion of like West African immigrants versus what you would call, you know, American blacks, what they would call Creole blacks back in the past. What I can say is that there have been discussions, you know, historically, there have always been these discussions about what happens, what difference between American blacks, let's call it that, versus indigenous Africans. There have always been discussions about that, and that was in Morton's era, and what the impacts of slavery are, and the impacts of racial mixture. I think that it is part of our. I think it's part of our culture. You hear me stammering because I'm not sure exactly how to address this. I haven't studied it, but I think that's something worth looking into. Let me put it that way. Is this sort of tradition, this history of talking about whether African-born blacks are somehow different from American-born blacks? There was also discussions in the past. They talked about the nación, which is a Portuguese term or Spanish term, which meant the nation or the tribe where somebody came from in Africa. And I read some documents where they talked about the slave, the guys who were acquiring slaves. That's interesting, use that term. Who were picking them up in Africa. They felt that certain nations, certain tribes, their nations, were better at certain tasks than others. And they would say, well, this one, I think it was Igbos, they said, made better domestic servants. And other people made better, like, would work with rice paddies. And it was almost like getting a breed of horses. So this notion that somehow there are distinctions between where black people come from, either in Africa or in the United States, those discussions have been going on for a long time. Whether they're reflected in these discussions today, I can't say, but it's something that would be worth looking into. I feel bad. I can't give you a better answer than that. But those are the things that pop into my mind with that. There was also something which I remember seeing when they were talking about in Cuba, where they felt it was better to purchase an African-born slave because they would work harder, and that the Cuban-born slaves, they knew the system. So they would figure out ways to avoid having to do work. That was the perception. You know, that was what they reported back then. So this notion, I mean, it's interesting that you talk about that and, the model minority. It's interesting. I wish I could give you a better answer.
Okay. Last question. So, I mean, and you know, you don't really have to have scholarship on it, just opinion. Do you think the language, when you go on Stormfront or you watch even what people would call a metaphorically dog whistles. Do you think laziness has replaced IQ as it relates to talking about the disparities and the problems facing Black people in America and worldwide? So they no longer talk about IQ, they just talk about work ethic and one group being lazy and the other just being, you know, more just more has a better work ethic. Do you hear that or do you see that?
So I'm going to answer that yes. And as if you've been listening to the show, I haven't answered anything in very blunt terms. I want to be nuanced, but yeah, you just see that. You see that sort of use of language going way back historically. You see it in, you know, in documents back then, you know, in the 19th century. You see sort of these ways to, you know, subtle ways to dig in at people and imply that they're inferior, you know, lazy. They talk about morality. They talk about, was it arrested in development? This notion that people are more childlike and they never mature. You do see a lot of that, and it's consistent in all the stuff that I've seen into the, you know, the early 20th century. So, I have not been saying yes or no to a lot of these questions, but that one, it seems like yes, it is.
Victim in New Jersey, did that answer your question? Or?
Yes. Thanks a lot. Sorry about the microphone issue.
Thank you. That is not a problem, sir. All trying to do our best. Thank you. Let's see. We had a person who wrote in, Mr. Michael. Other folks, if you have questions, *61605 is the number. Sorry, I'll do it not to confuse. 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you have a question. We had a listener who wrote in. Peaceful greetings. Thank you for taking my question. Currently at the plantation. Have to write in. Know that feeling. Thank you, Mr. Michael, for your informative participation. My question is, what is the infatuation that people classified as white have with digging up bones and not returning them? What do you think, Mr. Michael?
So, let me process this. The Enlightenment in Europe, the scholarship in Europe, late 1500s, 1600s, there was the Europeans and then later Americans, white South Americans, the colonizers, were really interested in gathering all kinds of materials from wherever they went. It was partially just interest, scientific, but it was kind of commercial as well. The more you knew about a place, the more you could extract resources from it. And at least, you know, in terms of like the slave trade, they were interested in what kind of people lived in a place. Were they people who could be enslaved? Were they people who had a tradition of slavery and would have some, you know, some notion of where it was? And so people were chattel. And just as they were collecting bits and pieces of animals, birds, fossils, so the bones of people also came into that category. If you are in the mindset, like a hardcore polygenist, that Adam was white, and that all the white people descended from Adam, but all other peoples of the world did not, then in their mindset, collecting a skull from the Aztecs would be just like a human skull would be just like collecting the skull of a bird that lived in Mexico. So that's the initial acquisition, which seems to be the theme. You acquisition parts of people just like you acquisition parts of animals. And the original Morton was at the Academy of Natural Sciences of Philadelphia. They weren't like an anthropological institute. The study of anthropology really sort of was not like a formalized thing. They used to call it ethnology. So they were collecting these bones, hair samples, you name it, just as if they were collecting any other animal. They did, to some degree, collect white people, ancient Romans, ancient Celts, ancient Germans, but they didn't seem to put any noblemen's or their friends or their family, and so that's how all these human remains got there. As far as returning them, I think it was really, it's really only been recently that, and especially in North America, that Native Americans, African Americans, people of color, have gained enough political power and economic power to really insist that, that these things be returned. It's not always an easy process to do. The museums are, at this point, I think they're very, they've become very sensitive to that. One of the problems is, if there is a, some of these skulls which is gathered and nobody quite knows where they belong. And that's part of the problem with Morton is Morton's records are not good on certain of these skulls. So it's like, you don't know who to return them to. So there is a, there's a difficulty in that. I think the reticence, a lot of the museums they're kind of overwhelmed and they don't know what to do. And some of the like indigenous groups don't have the kind of, I don't know, technical assistance that they need to document for sure that where these skulls came from. This is a big problem. I think in the past, yeah, nobody cared. And the people in charge was the white society. In the past, nobody cared. I think now that's changing, but there's still huge difficulties in trying to figure out where some of these things belong. There was a skull I worked with in the Morton collection called it was a Seminole girl. And she had some writing on the side of the skull, which indicated what tribe she was from. And I believe that one got returned to the Seminoles. And I remember that skull so well. And it was just like so many of the skulls, they were just anonymous. You know, you didn't really know who they were, but for her, she really had an identity. And I feel glad she wasn't Bennett. There was no Bennett research benefit. And that's kind of where we are now. It's not an easy process.
The person who wrote in, they had another question. I'll read their second question. I'm just going to play the sound clip because what does it mean to be white? I even submit white culture. We've been talking about all this over generations. Most of our conversation about Dr. Morton and these skulls in Cuba and such, they're talking about things that happened 200 years ago. Right? More recently, I was trying to play a different segment from Pulp Fiction, Nobody Who Will Be Missed, one of my favorites, talking about a black male. Who cares? This one fits as well. I'll play this and then we'll get question two. Pulp Fiction?
In fact, what the fuck am I doing in the back? You the motherfuckers should be on brain detail. We fucking switching. I'm washing the windows and you picking up this nigga's skull.
The great Samuel L. Jackson. They're seen picking up a Negra's skull. Doctor, but give it right here. I'll take it. No problem. Clean it right up for you. Put that in my collection with the rest of them. But that right there. total lack of regard for black in life, even in death, because what they clean all that up, put it in the trunk, take it to Joe's, Monster Joe's junkyard in the trunk. Goodbye. Nobody who will be missed. Question two. What study needs this much genetic material that spans over hundreds of years? That's question two, Mr. Michael. What do you think?
I'm not sure I understand the question number two.
This is the same person
who
asked about white people digging up bones and not returning them. And their question, the follow-up is, what study needs this much genetic material that spans over hundreds of years? So I think they're talking about some of these cases where, okay, you got it.
Yeah, so there is the DNA testing is relatively new that we've been doing that, and it can tell you a lot of things. There are some people who are very opposed to DNA testing because they feel it's doing violence against the in this case the skulls. Another argument to be made is that, well, this is almost like a crime scene. If you found a body at the scene of a crime, you would want to give that person's identity. You would want to find who that person is, give them their identity in a way that's argued that that's the respectful thing, to give them their identity. Given these, there are masses of these skulls in different places. This is going to be a wimpy answer, but if you've got information, let's say there are lots of skulls all over the world that come from Peru, because the Peruvians mummified their dead, and then the Peruvian Empire fell to the Spanish, and it was reduced. And so there's these Peruvian skulls all over the place. I don't know that anybody needs to do intense DNA studies on Peruvian skulls to find out, any useful information. What are you going to find out from them? On the other hand, there are people called Guanches, who were the indigenous people of the Canary Islands, of whom there were very few. And I think I can see an argument for saying, well, let's get to DNA because we could find out more about the Guanches, more about, human varieties, human diversity. It almost is like the wisdom of Solomon to know when to use it and when not to use it. I'm not of the opinion that it should never be used. I'm not of the opinion that it always should be used. You gotta figure out, are you gonna get something that's gonna be worthwhile, that's gonna be novel and provide something useful? And in some cases, it's not. I guess that's the position I have to take, yeah.
Okay. I want to make sure I get this in because I'm familiar with Sarah Bartman. We've talked about her before, but I had not read about this particular context. This is from the Bias Brains and Skulls report. Skipping down a little bit, you write, in 1795, German anatomist Johann Friedrich Blumenbach, there we go, division of the human species, into five interrelated but cranially categorized racial varieties, in quotes, Americans, Caucasians, Ethiopians, Malays, and Mongolians, both instituted enduring categories and prefaced 19th century studies of brain size. Others would share an attention to the skull as a locus of racial difference, including Dutch anatomist and artist Petrus Camper, German anatomist Samuel Thomas von Sommering, and French naturalist Jorge Cuvier. Forgive the pronunciation. Cuvier's 1817 report on a dissection of the Venus Hottentot Sarah Bartman in Paris asserted her small brain and resemblance to a monkey, undergirding his claim of the inferiority of Africans and their incapacity for civilization. For Cuvier, there proved no exception to this cruel law, which seems to have condemned to eternal inferiority. Nothing can be done about it. Sorry. The races with cramped and compressed skulls. Boy, he put it on us, didn't he? Man, what? I hadn't even heard about this part because so much of it is focused on other parts of her anatomy. She's got a tiny no-count brain and nothing can be done. What is it? She's got a cramped and compressed skull? Dang.
Yeah, that was, that is, some of these things are bad and some of these things are very bad. And her treatment was horrible. I could talk for 3 hours just on the skull studies of Blumenbach and Zummering, who were a generation before Morton. But how can I do this quickly? With human remains, many of the bones just deteriorate, but skulls are more solid, so they tend to last, and they're also easier to transport. And so, studying skulls was one of the earliest ways that race scholars tried to study race. Blumenbach, who was in Germany, he said, I've studied these skulls. They look relatively similar. I think that the differences are, I forget what he said, something like minor and environmental. And he said, yeah, there are different people in different parts of the world, but they all blend together at one point or another. So that you have Europeans and you have Ethiopians, which is what we'd call sub-Saharan Africans. But he said, but the Egyptians are kind of a bridge. So he said there was like a racial spectrum. However, that those five categories that he looked at, other people said, oh, no, they're separate and distinct. They said, we're going to follow Blumenbach, but we're going to say that Blumenbach said there was a spectrum. We're going to say they're separate and distinct. And so then they started to look for examples. And they didn't have, especially in Europe at that time, they had a limited knowledge of the Far East in places like China or the South Pacific. So Sarah Bartman was one of the first, what they call Kung San people. And she went to Europe. And so they almost took her to be like the typical. And her to be, like, if you get one person, well, you can say something about one person, you can say it about everyone. And that kind of approach, they continued to do for a long time. It took another, really, two generations, people like Frederick Tiedemann to say, you have to study populations. You just can't look at individual skulls. But at that time, that was very early on, they would find one or two skulls and make all kinds of grand pronouncements. And we kind of, look at them as being, in a way simple or the Neanderthal skulls that we get today, they don't find very many of them. In some respects, when we find fossils of dinosaurs, you just find one or two and people come up with grand theories because that's all they have. And back in those days, they didn't have as much, and they made grand theories. And for those people who were, I would say for those people who were inclined to be race supremacists, just like they used Darwinism to support race supremacy, just like they used the Bible, then they'd take somebody's skull. If they really want to prove that point, they'll cherry pick the evidence to support it.
That was the
word. I could go on for 3 hours, but I'll stop.
That was the word for the broadcast. Before we let you enjoy the rest of your evening, try to ask as many of our white guests this question as possible. Just in your studies, you study a lot of the older work on this early kind of racist pseudoscience. In your view, and you're familiar with Dana Ramey Berry's work and some of the other scholarship, in your view, who do you think is more informed about what racism, white supremacy is, how it works, that system, the ins and outs all over the world, how it operates. Who do you think is more informed about all of that? Do you think the people classified as white, like yourself, are more informed? Or do you think the non-white people are more informed about what racism is, how it works?
Unreservedly, it's not white people. What I always find is, you know, when I'm talking to groups about this, so much of this stuff, as I say, I do have to explain it to white people, and, you know, at least for black people. And I think this is the same, you know, for the Chinese in California. It's the same for Latin American people living in Texas and California. It's probably the same for native Greenlanders in Denmark. It's probably the same for the lower castes in India. They learned it from their grandmother. I mean, you tell people stories about how bad things could be. I didn't learn it from my grandmother because she didn't experience it. And I actually find it's often, people, I'm white and I talk to groups, sometimes black groups and other groups like that. And, you know, is it difficult or do you feel embarrassed? And for me, it's like, no, it's actually easier because black Americans are not shocked. You know, they're not shocked to hear this stuff because their grandparents told them about it. And for a lot of white people, they've been just so separated from it, because we had lived in a segregated society for so long.
Fascinating. You are informed about racism, though, because you've written these reports, Sarah Bartman, and you said you give talks about it and such. So you are informed, Mr. Michael, as a white man, correct?
I suppose I am, but I never. There was a musical. What's it called? Avenue Q, with puppets. It was sort of like a Sesame Street, and they said, and there's one song that goes, "Everyone's a little bit racist," and it's satirical. It's funny, but hey, I catch myself all the time. I catch myself all the time. And it's just kind of like, I have these assumptions, and I'm not going to sit there and go, I am a woke white man. I'm just better informed. Yeah.
Whoa. When was the last time that you caught yourself doing or saying something racist?
It's always little things. It tends to always be little things. The classic example was when I was younger. I was working at a print shop, and we dealt with a lot of law firms, and the assistants, legal, what do they call them? Paralegals were mostly women and mostly middle-aged women. And this was in Philadelphia. So, you know, I'd say, you know, 20% of them were black. And this one woman came up to me and she wanted me I had to copy some papers for her. And her name was something like, and it was usually women would come and they would, the name of the law firm would be a man's, it would be a male lawyer. And her name was something like Lee Murphy. And as I was filling out the form for her, I said, "And who are you with?" Because I assumed she was a paralegal. "Who are you with?" And she said, "Blah, blah, 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 blah." And I said, "And what's your name? Da, 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 da. And who is this for?" And she puts her finger on the document. And it says, you know, the solicitor, Lee Murphy. And she goes, "Lee Murphy." And I felt like crawling under a rock, but that's what I did. I'm sure she felt horrible. But that was, you know, That was my first assumption. I grew up in America. Guilty. You know, I'm not going to, I'm not going to candy coat that either.
Known universe, individuals classified as white. We've heard similar incidents all throughout the world. So it's not just America, but wow. Okay. Much obliged. I guess you can give us the website so we can go and check out, listeners can go and get some of the reports that we've been chatting about this here evening. Where is the easiest spot where they can go and get these documents, your great research?
So it's academia.edu. And if you do academia.edu and then you go for John S. Michael, M-I-C-H-A-E-L. And one of the nice things about academia.edu is it's where lots of scholars post their material. So you don't have to go to a library. You don't have to buy a journal that hardly anybody sees. I get a lot of really good materials. You talk about don't believe what you see in videos, believe what you read in books. I'm 100% behind you on that. There's so much misinformation, and that academia.edu is a really good place to go to see, my papers, other people's papers. You don't agree with all of them. Other people are not going to completely agree with me, but it's written down. It's got citations. People have given it some thought. It's not some quick YouTube video that you don't know who it came from. So it's a great site to visit just in general. They're not paying me to say this either.
I will share your academia.edu site so folks can do some research if they like. I have some papers there myself. Dr. Tommy J. Curry, many of our guests who have been on the program and shared great work, they also published there. Great resource, I agree. I do just want to clarify, strive for accuracy. I said reading is more important than watching television. There are many authors who lie as well. We've been talking about that this evening, where they cherry pick and misrepresent, bell curve you, and all the rest of it. So you have to be careful even when you read. Columbine, even when you read, people do lie. Authors do lie. Isn't that right, Mr. Michael?
In history, they say, they diverge from the facts.
See, there. Yeah. They got all those wacky euphemisms and says, hey, fudged it a little bit. See there, diverge. That is widespread. Woo, have to be careful about that, too. Wow. Much obliged for giving up a bit of your Wednesday evening, Mr. Michael. I enjoyed the, and again, John J. Audubon. I cannot emphasize enough. That is how we got here. I didn't even know anything about this guy. And now, wow, I know every time Audubon Society and the birds and all that. Now I will think digging up skulls, sending them off to his homie, Dr. Morton, Philadelphia. Get to Philadelphia and hit the libraries. Thank you so much again, Mr. Michael. I learned a bunch.
Well, thank you for your skepticism. Keep it up.
Hey, I will encourage listeners to do the same. Much obliged, Mr. Michael. I will keep an eye on your scholarship. Like I said, I'm going to share your academia.edu. So yeah, we will be readers. Take care. We will speak down the road.
Thanks a lot.
For sure. Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Mr. John S. Michael. If you give me a moment, I will get his academia page and pass it down the line for you all to check out. We'll be here for the book club tomorrow, normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Columbine, natural selection on the t-shirt. That's at least one part of the book. Accurate. They got pictures and all to substantial, and he wrote it all throughout the journal, natural selection with Dodds and all the rest of it. So we'll return to that tomorrow, normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We'll take a short break, see if folks have any thoughts, what they heard from our guest, any other observations to share before we get ready to wrap things up. Just brief interlude, and then we will be right back. Context of White Supremacy.
And from the late 1960s, after the death of Martin Luther King and the riots and the upheavals and all like this, and black people with their fists in there and all like that, and trying to stumble and fumble and find their way and get focus, the white supremacists made a blueprint and put it in action. And that is, I'm going to have these people so confused, they don't even know what they started out to do. And by the late 1970s, they had just about completed it. And we've been on that ever since. And you mentioned something very important. They are more comfortable than ever. But see, it's like making gorillas comfortable in a cage, or monkeys, or pandas. You still got them in a cage, but they are comfortable. See, so give him some bling bling. It's like giving an animal a brand new car and training the animal to ride up and down the street in it. And then you stand back and point at the animal. Like one white man said in the late 1950s, he said he doesn't care what kind of car a Negro has. He said he's still a nigger. And when he rides by in a shiny car, to him, it's just a monkey in a car. White people built a car, put a monkey in it, trained the monkey to drive the car, so now you're looking at a monkey in a car. See, but black people don't see themselves that way. But this is how the white supremacists see us, and they are the ones who run our business. And we have to know that, that when they look at us, that's what they see. That's what they see. And at a subliminal level, what they see begins to spill over into our brains so that we, at a subliminal level, see each other that way. And indirectly see ourselves that way.
Context of white supremacy. Indeed. Indeed. I'd never heard that before. We've had programs. We've talked about Sarah Bartman before repeatedly. In fact, I'd never heard, wow, you got white people to come and steal her skulls. See, told you. Got these old, let me give you the exact quote again. Got these old cramped, compressed skull Negroes. They only recently returned her remains, Sarah Bartman. I mean, like within the last 10 years, I think it's less than 10, but I mean, this is a real recent thing. What does it mean to be white? And in fact, put all of this in context, Neely Fuller Jr., he said, if I had to pick one person, essence of what white supremacy racism is all about, he said, I would pick Jeffrey Dahmer. Got the body parts and keep them right there and store. You heard with the Harvard situation, that's right now. We had that on the compensatory call-in. It was a white woman at an oddity shop who was spending all this money to buy body parts. They had a white man, he was buying skin to tan. Now, even that. Said he was making leather out of it. Real human skin. Who does that? That's what they did. Delectable Negro. Mentioned that book. He talked about the different flavors of white supremacy racism. That's in Delectable Negro, where they cannibalized Nat Turner after his capture in Virginia. Same time period that we were talking about, really. I thought it was so fascinating. He had chuckles at such significant moments. Even that point where I talked about his quoting Frederick Douglass, cowbell, and when he went in his stream of metaphors and he was chuckling there, I thought that was so important, as well as on the way out when I asked him who's informed about racism, and that one, now he was pussyfooting and doing all this about the other responses, but that one, unequivocally, no hesitation, immediate. Not white people. They are more informed. And boom, boom, boom. He gave his explanation. He said, well, you're informed. That we got the chuckle, the hesitation. Well, wait a minute. I suppose, I mean, see, and then it went to catch myself. He said it twice. He said, it's the little things. The little things. He said it twice. I said, moo. Minimize. White supremacy, racism is always minimized. Even the incident that he gave us, sounds like it was a black female head of a law firm, right? That she came in, get her legal copies and what have you, get her documents for court or whatever. And he's thinking she's the secretary or the paralegal, the help. And she has the point, like, even that, there are so many situations where a black person who actually is a CEO or a judge or something other than a no-count shiftless Negro, but they're not recognized as such, and that ends up with a police call or security or, you know, a major conflagration. I think even Cynthia McKinney, when she was a congresswoman, she was going through security, and it was a big kerfuffle about her showing her badge. And I think this happened as well with some other, you know, high-profile black people who were not recognized and all the rest of it. So white supremacy racism is not minimal. At all. It's not a little thing. It's not micro terrorism on a grand scale, universal scale at that. Anywho, I'm trying to think of other important details I want to make sure to emphasize. One, the pseudoscience, man, so many of these white people that he talks about, they lie. And even the resistance to that, they lie. They sit here and I know these niggers are racist, so I'll just, you know, do whatever. I'll make up science or whatever. I know he emphasized that Morton was basically accurate with his measurements, but there'll be so many other ways that they will lie, cherry-picking. When you omit data that discredits or tends to refute your position, and you just omit, ignore that, leave that out, that is lying. You are being deception, and there's so much of that. What we talked about and just... master, that's one thing that I say consistently. The more you read, reading is one way that you can learn about deception. Because a lot of times white people will have to write about other white people being deceptive and how they figured this out or problems that it caused, that sort of thing. Enron. But this is a recurring pattern in white history, white culture, right to this very day. But read Columbine. Everyone said, oh, they were bullied and picked on. Poor guy. Inaccuracies and all of that stuff. So strive for accuracies. Do more reading. Oh, man, right in that vein. What he said at the very beginning. I was glad I asked then because I would have got off on other subjects where he emphasized the old libraries in Philadelphia. We got our caller in New Jersey and New York. I'm sure they have old libraries there as well. Those places on the East Coast, the original 13 colonies, probably have lots of old libraries where you can go and read, do some digging. What I say all the time, learn about local history. He said at the beginning, Philadelphia, that another hub, trafficking in Negro bodies, pause for Kendrick Johnson. That's Georgia, not Philadelphia, I know. But pause for Kendrick Johnson. That is the system of white supremacy racism. You heard the Harvard morgue, that's days ago. That's not ancient history. Trafficking in body parts and buying and all the rest of it. Who knows what's on the so-called dark web. This was on PayPal, though. They weren't even trying to be discreet. They had in the news report, they got it from PayPal. You can invest in the cows, PayPal. Hit the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com. PayPal button in the top right corner. Beneath the button, you'll see the links, Cash App, Venmo, and PayPal. Nobody puts anything incendiary in my PayPal messages. They said they were sending messages to the manager at the Harvard morgue. Harvard morgue. $600. Brains. You can't be discreet about it. You can't come up with a code. $600, cabbages, something. You can't come up with something. Might be no type of discrepancy. Even that, to me, what does it mean to be white? The rules are for the Negros. I do what I want. But buy me a skull. Get me some brains. Make me some leather out of human skin. Robert Berdella, we talked about him the end of last year, talking about the serial killer, Kansas City metropolitan area. He said, man, you know about Robert Berdella? I said, no, I don't. He had an oddity shop as well, in addition to being a serial killer and rapist. I think he was a cannibal too, but he had an oddity shop. Ooh, come see the shrunken head and the human skull, hand with eight fingers. Ooh. Talked about that on last Friday, Dr. Fatala. I asked her directly. I said, is that white culture? Do you see that anywhere else in the world? She said, nope. The Jeffrey Dahmer memorabilia shop? Are you serious? What does it mean to be white? Necrophilia has been one of our terms for 14 years. Anyway, let's see. Victim in New Jersey. Any other folks, observations, thoughts that they wanted to get in before we wrap up? We'll be here tomorrow for the book club, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Victim in New Jersey. See if anybody else.
Oh, sorry, Gus. I was on mute. Every time you ask the question about who's more informed, that's always interesting. And when you ask, you know about racism, and very bashful, and it just contradicts when I listen to news outlets or social media or even read books. These people, if you're in the business of praising white people, they'll just talk. But when you ask that question, they get bashful. Oh, well, I don't know. And like you said, they have access to all these books. So that always, it's not a laughing matter, but makes me chuckle. And also the minimizing. Even when you have so-called white allies, they don't, they talk about other white people. They talk about they're in the business of ending race. Hold on. Sorry, Gus. I'm always in the gym when I call. So they, the minimizing and they don't go as condemning the whole white collective, so they're knowledgeable enough to pull back. And I think that's where the question and answer comes in when you ask who's more informed. They know enough to pull back. They don't want to go too far and indict the whole white collective. Even the guest you had on a couple of weeks ago, are your parents racist? I don't really want to... I don't want to go there. Listen, you even had Colin Kaepernick go there and call out his white parents. I'm not sure if they were the adopted ones, but even he called out his parents' racism. Just the pseudoscience of it all and how racists cherry pick, to use a metaphor. They're very knowledgeable, so they know enough to go and find different racist academics to fit their narrative. And I guess that's where the, well, I know that's where this whole push for CRT and the suppressing of information, but the allowance of information that fits the narrative. Also, his minimizing didn't escape me, you know, when he talked about the professor, one of the writers. I'm not sure if it was Morton, if I'm not mistaken, but how he emphasized, oh, you know, well, you know, he was racist, but you know, he was a nice guy. You know, that fits into the narrative of, you know, he was just the man of his day. You know, if it wasn't for the racism, I mean, this is a nice guy, you know, in his 90s, 80s, this was grandpa, you know. So the minimizing of it all just always is what sparks is what I get from these conversations.
Much obliged, victim in New Jersey. I would not have thought about that. That good memory and great point, victim in New Jersey. He was talking about Josiah, not niggerology. It was a couple white people that he said they were racist, but they were jovial fellas. Great jokes and great conversationists and... That's a good point. Not funny, but yes. The person who wrote their question in, their commentary, Mr. Michaels completely obfuscated the cannibal aspect of digging up these bones, as in mummies and cannibals and vampires, by Richard Sugg, guest on the program way back when, guest on the Cows. I suspect Mr. Michaels was practicing racism, white supremacy, by suggesting the system, in quotes, isn't operated, refined, and practiced by people classified as white. I think he used the term institutionalized, that's in quotes. Thank you for the guest and the program. Hopefully worthy of your time and energy. That's what necrophilia, I said, that's been one of our concepts for well over a decade at this point. I was even thinking we were doing all that talking about Chicago, right? Because that was the guest he was talking about, Dr. Erica K. Jackson, when she was hemming and hawing last Wednesday about her parents who lived in a racially restricted region, 98% white, and by her own testimony, they were telling racist jokes. And I asked her, dang, were your parents racist? She said, whoa, I don't feel comfortable. Which is fine, you know, no problem. That's the answer we'll take. I just pointed out that lack of comfort, that could be an act of racism. And she concurred later on in the program. But, yeah, that sort of, you know, bashfulness around certain questions. Even the being informed, because we've had that a number of white people we've asked, you are informed about racism, and it's been amazing. I remember this time last summer, we spoke with the author about the Klan in Buffalo, New York State. And I said, you're informed about racism. Like, you've written whole books about racism. I said, well, you know, I had to ask him six times before he finally said, yes. Like, dang. I mean, what if the answer is no, you could have said that first. We didn't have to go through all this. But it was all that, you know, hemming and hawing. I do also want to include, this is not the most fun thing to be doing. Summertime, June, man, could be at the beach, partying, lots of fun things. Out for a hike, do some yoga outside, rooftop yoga, swim, all of the above, barbecue, veggies, of course, zucchini on the grill, squash. Man, I will never think about the assassination of Minister Malcolm X the same. Ever. Now it will be February 21, 1965. Minister Malcolm X El-Haj Malik Shabazz assassinated in the Audubon Ballroom, named after the race soldier accused of digging up Native American skulls. ship them to my homie in Philadelphia. That's what I'm even wondering. Dang, I wonder if Minister Malcolm knew that about John James Audubon. Did he know that? Maybe he was going to include that in his speech. I don't know. I will never think about that. Just I talk about that all the time. There's so many landmarks, right? When they go to talking about we got to take, you know, the Confederate flag down here after Dylann Roof shot up the church and everything, and got to change the name of this and all that. And they did here in Seattle. They did take the Audubon name off of the Bird Society here, the local branch anyway. But I said there's so much that you would have to change and rename and all the rest of it. And I would even include that, like in the assassination, like, man, this is how saturated we are by the system of white supremacy, racism, the symbolism, the codes, laws that govern, rule, propaganda of this system, paraphernalia of this system is everywhere. The iconography of the system, everywhere. Minister Malcolm X literally assassinated in a room by someone. I'm going to help you with your phrenology work. I got you. Amazing. Anywho, one other tidbit I will get in. It is ironclad code for me. I think it should be counter-racist logic for any non-white person. White people are not victims of racism. White people are not victims of racism, white supremacy. Now that's it. The exchange with Mr. Michael early on, we're talking about white people mistreating other white people, which they do. I said, yes, white people do practice racism against other white people. Now that, I just wanted to think about it, make sure, like, make sure I'm being accurate, counter-racist logic. Now, even after I thought about it, I said, oh, I do think that I would stick with that and say that that is true. One, I think you could say World War II, Adolf Hitler, him saying that these so-called Jews are not white people, that could be one example. If I had to pick out others, because white people have lots of disputes, that's why I said hierarchy. White people mistreat other white people. That's, you know, ironclad. I don't think that's debatable. But there's so much competing with other white people and all of this, and even disputes about how we're going to practice racism, white supremacy, that I do think sometimes it's because you didn't do the racism the way that I said you should, or you didn't practice racism the way that I think you should be doing it. You broke the code that we're supposed to have. Yeah, I do think sometimes they practice racism against other white people. Now, it might be better to just phrase that as they mistreat other white people, but man, if it's about you're not following the racist code in a manner that I think you should, we have disagreements about how the plantation should be operated, might be best to just say that as white people mistreat other white people. That's easy, but I think about that. White people practice racism against other white people. I have to think about that. Let's see. We should have many other broadcasts for the remainder of the week. Compensatory call-in on the weekend and book club, neutralizing workplace racism. People can let me know their thoughts on that as we proceed. Even folks can email in. I'll read them on the program as we proceed. I generally say white people mistreat other white people, but is that logical, accurate? White people practice racism against other white people. I have to think about it. I'll think about it. Folks can share their thoughts and such.
Hey, Gus.
Yes, sir.
Can I ask? Oh, sorry. Yeah, you know what's real interesting? Because I didn't really know that they thought so lowly of Russia. And you had a guest on, and I asked. Because, you know, Russia borders, if I'm not mistaken, the last guest, was it the... What was the classification of white people that was that immigrated to the United States that were seen as pure and you know, got special treatment? Was that Scandinavians, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes, sir.
Okay. But Russia borders, you know, Finland, Norway, you know, those northern countries. But however, they still border Eastern Asia, where you have the western part being Mongolia, China. So I always thought that the Russians' mistreatment was their proximity to the Orient, you know what I mean, what people would call Orientals. I definitely wanted to know, was that the reason why? And when you talk about landmarks, Gus, I probably wasn't aware of the Audubon Ballroom maybe 5 to 6 years ago, and I deliver in New York City, and I would pass this place every day on my way to the George Washington Bridge, until one day I looked to my right and I seen the Betty, you know, the Betty Shabazz, you know, Al Malik Shabazz center, like on top. And, you know, just with a little Googling, I found out, oh, wow, this is the Audubon Center. This is where Malcolm X was assassinated. And, you know, right in front of my face every day, 5 days a week, making deliveries right next to this place, had no idea.
Hey, that's lots of us are still, hey, put that. File that away, so when we ask who's more informed about racism, white supremacy, what it is, how it works, add that in. But hey, we are all still learning and doing the best that we can to be more informed. That's why I say, man, we should all be more informed about local history as much as we can, learn as much as we can, like go to those libraries, man, like take the tours and all that good stuff. If they have museums, a lot of times they'll have hookup. We had the listener, told you he wrote in, he said he took his child, offspring, to the museum because they have certain days or to be hooked up, they have discounts, or you get past, sometimes you can go for free, or if you have children, a lot of times they'll let them go for free. All of that, you can just go online and see what kind of packages you can get, a group together, they'll do discounts and all that good stuff. But go to those museums so that you can learn and be more informed. There's so much about the system of white supremacy, racism at a local level that's right there. And these would be great teaching tools, not just for ourselves, said the whole family. You know, we can make a trek, we'll go Audubon Ballroom, do a report as a family, learn about this, and then we'll go there, Dr. Betty Shabazz Center, read about her. Local history, to just be informed. And in fact, I was even trying to go back to get the program. One of our investors, Lauren, she mentioned it maybe over the weekend. She was talking about the Boston Marathon bombing and the program we did on that. And there we go. Susan Batachinko, white woman. She was with us way back in 2013. We talked about her report on the Tsarnaev brothers, and she said that they are Caucasian, not white. That's what I said about that hierarchy. She said if you had a chance to talk to them, they'd probably say, no, we are not white. We were not accepted as white people, even though they're very pale. And death penalty was reinstated for the Tsarnaev brother that is still living. I know some people talked about that. That was significant for them, but death penalty reinstated via the court. I was going to say recently, but it's not that recent. Anyway, but we talked about that, and that part of the, as he talked about that part of the world, ye are the, is it because they're close enough to China and some other places of the world that we generally associate with non-white people? Ye, not sure, but then all of that is further east. Like he was talking about the proximity, like Scandinavian countries, all of that stuff is way far east. Probably, I haven't looked at the map, but that's probably like thousands of miles. I know they do kilometers there, but whatever. It's like thousands of miles from that part of like eastern Russia to the pure, superior Nordic whites of Norway and Anders Breivik and all that. That's way far away. So, yeah, no association at all. Tough luck. Better move and all the rest of it. Let's see. Make sure I didn't miss anybody. But, yeah, Susan Batachinko, if folks want to go back and check that program. Susan Batachinko, the Boston Marathon bombers are Caucasian, not white, from April 2013. Whew, wowza. We were earning our money April 2013, because that is, the bombing was April 15. So, yeah, we were earning our money. Timely. Context of white supremacy. Stand by our work. Anywho, let's see. Make sure we did not miss anybody. Okay. Be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Book Club. Dave Cullen, Columbine, Neutralizing Workplace Racism on Friday. Compensatory call-in on Saturday. Much obliged for folks tuning in live or archive. Hopefully worthy of your time and energy. Can't believe I had the bell curve. He beat me to it. I had the bell curve written down. He got to it before I even mentioned it. Anywho, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. I think that was even talked about before. People, black people did not want to be out and about late at night, get drunk, ooh-wee, knocked over the head, and bang, got another one for the white medical students. That would be a good reason to stay sober, right? Anywho, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
no
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.